Welcome back to this class again, where we are considering the halogenated version of the different phosphorus species. So, we are talking about the phosphorus pentachloride, phosphorus trichloride and PF3. So, along with this PaCl3, we can have the PF3 also. So, that particular PF3, what we get like that of our phosphorus here, it is basically these two. So, we can have the different types of these bond distances and bond angles. So, this particular one will be shorter, the angles will also be shorter for these compounds. So, when we get this triphenyl phosphine and all these things, so we can utilize this as for oxidation also. So, if we get this PCl3, its reaction with O2. So, another interesting compound will get from there, and which is our twice of this plus O2. When we do the reaction at 50 degree centigrade, we get basically twice of POCl3. So, that twice of POCl3 is basically a free radical mechanism and which can be purified by fractional distillation. So, this mechanism of this reaction is through free radical. So, that particular free radical reaction we get for this particular production. So, here you see that if you have this, that means you can have this particular POCl3 formation. So, through that lone pair of electrons you get some oxygen over there, and those compounds are very useful by one of this particular process. Another one process, we can get it from P2O5, and that P2O5 we use it and its reaction with thrice of PCl3 and some extra chlorine, that gives us 5 of this POCl3, so phosphorus oxychloride. So, these are very useful because it can also go give you for this corresponding supply of chlorine, and we get this as the corresponding compound for making that esters. So, they are useful in ester making. And also it is useful for flame retardants, then it is useful as plasticizers, useful as hydraulic fluid, and also sometimes it can be very useful as good extraction agent. So, it is extracting good extracting agent. So, making this POCl3 will therefore be very useful process when you have tremendous demand for all these cases, that means starting from flame retardants to making this hydraulic fluids. So, next we see that how we can make this PF3 compound. So, PF3 compound like that of our other types of compound, like already we have seen that we can have that useful ligand is 3 phenyl rings attached to the phosphorus center. So, is a very simple one as your corresponding organophosphorus compound, where you can have the phosphorus center attached to the 3 phenyl ring, and will also be a very useful ligand system like your ammonia. So this particular one, that PF3, so making this PF3, how we get that? So in this particular case, starting from your PCl3, so we will have PCl3 plus thrice of ZnF2. So we will have this compound if we react this phosphorus trichloride with zinc fluoride. So reaction of this will basically give us two molecules of PF3 plus twice of, now the zinc fluoride will be converted to zinc chloride. And this particular one, if we compare, this is also a ligand to us, the triphenyl phosphine. And if we can have a typical metal ion center Mn plus, as we all know, and it can have several coordination sites, and some of these coordination sites can be occupied by triphenyl phosphine, some will be coordinated by the chloride ion. Sometimes we get as this corresponding one as the rhodium center or the palladium center, we get some useful catalytic site. Similarly, we can compare this with that of our PF3 thing with that of our triphenyl phosphine. So it can also be a very good ligand because it is a strong pi acceptor, it is a sigma donor, and it is a strong because you have electron withdrawing fluorine centers are there. So that is why they are strong pi acceptors, and these strong pi acceptors will be useful for making some different types of compounds in our hand. So what are those compounds? Basically, if we want to make a compound like this, say a nickel compound of 4 trifluorophosphine ligand attached to it, how we make it? So this will be very much similar to the compound what we know through the Mohn's process, that means nickel tetracarbonyl compound, this is also a tetrahedral one. So like that of nickel tetracarbonyl, we can make it from there with the supply of PF3 at a high temperature, because this is formed at room temperature, and some elevated pressure of the carbon monoxide. Here the pressure required for this trifluorophosphine is 35 MPa. So that basically gives us the corresponding production of this particular compound. So the ligand production, because these ligands are very much useful compound for catalytic industry, so we can make this, and we make this a phosphorus based ligand, and that phosphorus based ligand will be useful in giving you all these compounds. So phosphorus can also be useful for making a corresponding compound which is P double bond S, like that of our P double bond O. Whether we will be able to make this compound phosphorus sulfochloride, so this will be therefore your P double bond S Cl and Cl, so which is phosphorus in 5 oxidation state plus 5 oxidation state, so phosphorus 5 sulfochloride. This basically, again, simply by doing this reaction with PCl3 plus sulfur at a temperature of 180 degree centigrade in an autoclave, we get PsCl3. So all these compounds are basically useful for some purpose or other, and the phosphate esters, therefore, how we see the different phosphate esters, as I told you, that we can get these phosphate esters from the corresponding phosphoric acid. So, these phosphate esters can be very useful, like that of our different organophosphorus compounds. So, if we have the corresponding phosphorus center like this P double bonded O, and we can have this RO OR OR. So, these are the corresponding phosphorus centers, and those phosphorus centers can be useful for making these phosphate esters. Then we can have the phosphinic acids or phosphonic acids. And different phosphonates. So, in this particular case only, that since we do not have any phosphorus carbon bond over here in this phosphate esters, but this particular phosphonic acid and phosphonates, we will have a typical R function on it, and that R function is basically attached to the phosphorus center with O R, that R can be different. So, it can be O R prime. So, these basically giving you a much more complex compound, which is can be for the corresponding phosphonic acid, and definitely what we can have over there is our corresponding this function, that means phosphorus carbon bond over there. So, one such compound if we can make is therefore, very useful as making herbicides. So, how we get some industrially important leaf, the plant leaf herbicide, making of leaf herbicides, which is also very interesting to know from the environmental point of view. These are biodegradable. So, we have this biodegradable herbicides, which are basically based on the phosphorus, and they are useful for removing the weeds. So, they are useful for combating weeds. Sometimes it can reduce also the unwanted grasses in the field. So, they are very useful in the agricultural industry. So, one such compound if we can think of is a very simple one, because since we are talking all in terms of getting this as the phosphorus oxygen bond, and two other bonds are that OH-OH bond. So, one other bond, that means the fourth bond what we can have already in the typical phosphoric acid is your another POH bond, but instead of that if we can now have a carbon over here. So, that will be a typical different compound, and we can classify them as the typical organophosphorus compound, which is industrially very important, and making these as in a also in a very low scale also useful, because these are very good herbicides. So, if we take this and is also a very useful compound known as glyphosate, which is gly then PHOS phos then ate. So, it is basically a glycine based, gly is coming from glycine. So, and this phosphate ester thing will be the other part. So, it is a glycine based phosphate ester. Therefore, we get this as the corresponding nitrogen of the glycine through this carbon. So, it is attached to the nitrogen of that particular center through this particular carbon, and the remaining part is your glycine part. So, is a not only is a herbicide, is a which combats the weed also, it is also a crop desiccant. is a crop, one is probably, so crop desiccant. Is a crop desiccant. So, the compound is basically what? We have the N substituted this phosphate unit, N phosphono methyl glycine. So, if we know the typical reactions for all these things, because we can have the elaborate preparation procedure, we can have so many steps over there. So, we can use this as the carbon source from basically we utilize formaldehyde for introduction of this on glycine. So, if one hand you can have some other phosphorus based compound starting from your phosphoric acid, then formaldehyde or a other glycine part we can have, we can make this particular very important compound. So, next we will see another example where we get some drug molecule. Very few of these drug molecules are known which are phosphorus based. So, what are those phosphorus based drug molecules we can have? Based on the information or the knowledge whatever we have gathered so far, that means it should be a typical phosphate ester or some part can be also an amide part. So, phosphate ester part or the amide part in a very typical configuration, which is a typical anti-cancer drug, which is a cyclic one. So, cyclophosphamide. How we get that particular cyclophosphamide? So, already we have seen in case of the glyphosate preparation or glyphosate molecule itself, that is a long chain one. At one end we have the carboxy end and another end you have the phosphorus based acid part again. So, these two ends are basically the two acid ends. We cannot go for the typical cyclization reaction for that. So, we go for some other particular type of reactivity or the reaction for making this, but here only we will see that what is that particular compound, what we can get over here. So, the tetrahedral phosphorus we can have and the cyclophosphamide part we get. So, basically the cyclophosphamide, or we can also the one part as the ester and the another part is the corresponding NH function, and making this as the typical 6-member ring. So, this is the cyclic part, cyclic phosphamide. And basically, when we get this as this one, we can have further nitrogen over here and CH2 CH2 Cl1 and another CH2 CH2 Cl over here. So, these complex molecules we can get from all the different types of phosphorus based compounds, taking into idea that we go for the preparation of different esters or the different amide, because the phosphoric acid is a typical inorganic acid which can give rise to the different reactions based on making these esters or the amides. So, next we see that what we get for a typical molecule which is deadly also is known as a typical nerve agent. So, what is that particular nerve agent? Basically, nerve agent is nothing but the gas, which is a deadly gas. These gases are very deadly and they basically disturb the mechanism of the nerves. So, they basically disrupts the mechanism by which our nerves transfer messages to two different organs. So basically is the idea that we just basically block this transfer of messages of the different nerves. That is why it is known as a nerve agent. So very quickly, basically within 10 seconds or 20 seconds time, we can kill people if they inhale these gases. So basically when we disrupt this, basically they go like blocking the or one particular molecule, which is acetylcholine. So they block basically blocking acetylcholinesterase. Because acetylcholine is your neurotransmitter, which basically transfers the corresponding nerve signals, transferring the messages to the different organs, how your different organ can function, all these things. So these phosphorus based nerve agents, so these are phosphorus based like the drug molecules. So these phosphorus based nerve agents basically go for blocking this particular neurotransmitters, which is your acetylcholine. So one such compound, will take one example only, and which is very useful as where we can use these nerve agents as the chemical weapon. So it's a chemical war also. When we use these chemical weapons for chemical war, killing a mass destruction or mass killing of people of one country to the other, we can use this particular one. So we have the P double bonded O attached to some methyl group. That means you can establish the phosphorus carbon bond over there. And like your PF6, we get this as the corresponding fluorine compound, because the corresponding covalent nature of the phosphorus fluorine bond is different. So that is why instead of chlorine or oxygen or OH, we have this fluorine bond, and then we basically get is as the corresponding oxygen from the isopropyl function. So is a basically isopropyl function over there. So isopropyl ester, we get it. So this particular compound is known as sarin, is well known. So this sarin basically is a chemical weapon for that, and in the Syrian city Douma recently, the Syrian city Douma, people are suspecting that this has been attacked, this has been used for a chemical attack. Is a very recent story, killing 70 people. This year only, 2018. So is Douma is a Syrian city in Syria. So how we get this compound? So what are the things we can have? So when we talk about the corresponding making of this compound, we should have the corresponding philosophical aspect, that how we make it. We know that the phosphorus, we get it from the elemental phosphorus. So how you can convert it to phosphorus trichloride or phosphorus trifluoride. Even you know how the Grignard reagent can be useful for establishing the corresponding methyl function on the phosphorus center. So if we can take a corresponding compound like MePCl2, which we can have, already we have the corresponding methyl phosphorus bond. That means it is already a organophosphorus compound, and we react with SO2Cl2 to get is as MEP double bonded OCl2. So this phosphoryl chloride, in all other cases, in all other organic chemistry reactions, we know that this SO2Cl2 can be useful for supplying chlorine to that particular other compound, is a chlorinating agent also. But here you see is a typical reaction. So this particular reaction, it is supplying the oxygen to the phosphorus center. So, this is giving you the starting material for making this serine molecule, and we get SOCl2 from that. So, in the next step, basically when we utilize this with the reaction for substituting this particular one, that means we substitute now these two chlorine by two fluorine molecules. So, that means the corresponding fluorine salts we get. So, use of NaF or hydrofluoric acid will convert this molecule, that means you get these two, that means the substitution of this Cl2 will be by these two fluorine unit. So, you have the P double bond O and these two are your F. Then reaction of this from this alcohol part. So, alcohol part is the your isopropyl alcohol. So, we use this with that of our isopropyl alcohol, and reaction of this isopropyl alcohol giving us this compound back. That means, you prepare this with that of our serine molecule. So, making this particular molecule gives us all the ideas that how we get this as the corresponding formation of these and introduction of PCl bond, hydrolyzing ability of that particular bond, and also converting that particular one through a deadly poisonous gas molecule, and that gas molecules are very useful. So, definitely is very lethal and deadly also to us. So, handling this phosphorus compound, because all these very deadly things we are handling. We are not only handling the phosphorus, we are handling the sulfur centers on this particular molecule. But at one end, we have seen that simple PF3 molecule, the simple, that means if we try to compare this with that of PF3 molecule, which is a very good ligand, giving you us this corresponding metal ion complexes or metal complexes in the zero oxidation state, such that or that of our nickel 0. So, with this basically we have this particular situation where we get and where we see for making this diphosphonates, calcium phosphonates to up to the serine molecules. And lastly, with this particular slide, we try to understand how we get the different types of hydroxy apatites. In our previous class, I told you that you can get this as a typical bone material or teeth material, where instead of the simple phosphate PO4 is the PO4, so Ca10PO4⁶OH. That means you can have the hydroxide groups, and sometimes those hydroxide groups can be substituted by fluorides known as the fluorapatites. So, hydroxy apatite or fluorapatite, they can have a typical type of crystal structure, and when we write this as a formula which is double the amount of that which usually we write as a Ca5 molecule, but when you write as the Ca10 molecule, that means it has a different composition, that means it unit cell has two entities, and is both of these two things, that means either a Ca5 molecule or the Ca10 molecule is present in our bone and teeth material. And mostly our bone material is made up primarily by this with this hydroxy apatite, and is 65 to 70% of the bone mass is this particular one, and which these crystals are spread over within our collagen matrix, and the collagen is basically trapping for the growth of this biomaterial. So, it is basically a very useful biomaterial which has a very similarity with the naturally occurring apatite molecule. So, this we also consider as the biomineralization in our body when we have the regular supply of not only the calcium ions, but also the phosphate anions. So, the laboratory techniques or the laboratory processes, those we can have also. So, how we can prepare in the laboratory, that means if we just go for the synthetically prepared the bone material or the synthetically prepared teeth material, what we can have? Can be, these can be synthesized by different methods, and one such method is our wet chemical deposition. But what we get that in both the two components in solution, we add one component to the other, we get the precipitate and we ultimately it is settles down, that means we get the corresponding deposition. Then biomimetic deposition, that means if we have the collagen matrix on that matrix, that means you have the matrix support like that of our simple filter paper support or some cloth material or some jute material, if we can have that particular support, and on that support if we just go for the deposition of this material, that means the crystallization of that material in a very slow and a regular manner, we get this as a corresponding filled matrix with that apatite material. Then we can have the typical sol gel material is a wet chemical precipitation method, that means formation of the corresponding sol form and which has been converted to the gel, and then heating that particular material will give you the corresponding hydroxy apatite material, which is basically a phosphorus based useful material, biomaterial, what we can make in the laboratory also, or sometime we can get it as a typical electrode deposition also. So, the very basic reaction what we can have in our hand is that simple reaction of the calcium hydroxide what we get. So, this calcium hydroxide what we can take, which can be immediately react with that of our phosphoric acid. So, 10 molecules of calcium hydroxide when reacted with 6 molecules of H3PO4, we get this particular compound as Ca10PO4⁬OH⁔ with 18 molecules of water. So, simple direct reaction between two components, one is A, another is B, we get a compound which is your very basic compound, which is your hydroxy apatite molecule, and that hydroxy apatite molecule, if it gets a solid support, it can be formed as a biomaterial, which can be a corresponding biomimetic material for our bone and our teeth samples. Thank you very much.